I am very happy to be here and giving this talk to this audience. I will be talking about some works I did with Gerald Dunn in 2012, also in new lights of mixed anomalies where they stand. This is really an admixture of two methods. One of them is resurgence semiclassics, and the other one is mixed anomalies. And it's an idea to try to understand quantum field theory non-perturbatively as much as possible. So here is the motivation that we sort of put as a goal to ourselves in 2012. So there is this very famous question which one can perhaps attribute to Dyson or to Hooft. Whether we can make sense out of quantum field theory or whether there's a continuum definition of quantum field theory. Of course, all of us know that these are very difficult questions. I will just make these remarks due to Mike Douglas, given in StringMath 2011. Says that, you know, we can construct Euclidean functional integral. You know, there is no difficulty defining Gaussian integrations. So, and these, you know, developing these PRSD and BV formulations. But the real difficulty, he quotes, is that QFT is still not rigorous, is that standard perturbation theory only provides only an asymptotic divergent expansion. Of course, this audience is not unhappy with this statement. Rather, they are happy because it is the series is asymptotic, so we can do something interesting with it. We can do something useful. Okay. So this was partially our motivation. By the way, during my talk, if you have questions, please feel free to ask any time you would like to do so. And in the last many years, a number of people got interested with this kind of question in the context of quantum field theory, string theory. A number of these folks are in the audience. You know, I've been particularly influenced by the work of course, Ekal primarily, and also Marinho's Chiappa in the context of string theory matrix models, which are quite interesting. Also, the talks, many talks by Konsevich and his work with Soibelman and other people who are not in the audience. Of course, we all know that the main theme of this kind of ideas is sourced by Ekal's resurgence theory. And this is applied very usefully by Pham, Delaber, Voros, and others in Justin to quantum mechanics. So the main promise of the resurgence theory that all of us know quite well is that it is a way to combine perturbation theory with non-perturbative methods, and it's a way to extract information about one concerning the other. This is the main goal, okay? And so our physical motivation, as I said, the question of whether there's a non-perturbative continuum definition of quantum field theory, And here, I do not mean something formal. I've been personally very much influenced by lattice field theory. And lattice field theory is not only something formal, it is something of practical utility. I really mean a continuum definition, not in a formal sense, but also in a practical sense. That's something that we can calculate things. A more modest question is that whether we can make semi-classical methods exact. And when is this possible? And in this context, I would like to say a few things later on the connection between resurgence expansion and Lefschetz symbols that Maxim commented this morning. But I want to make this remark about something. When I was much younger, I read Coleman's lectures on instantons, and one statement there that bothered me tremendously was the fact that these saddles are of measure zero in either pet integral or ordinary integrals. I was deeply disturbed by this thing, and nowadays, at least in many integrals that we can deal with semi-classical methods or by using Picard-Lefschetz theory, we think that the effect of the saddles is not measure zero, but rather measure one. So we can map many integrals exactly to some of Lefschetz symbols. So, you know, if you ask this kind of questions, you immediately find yourself in a realm of a number of interesting questions in quantum field theory. One of them is something called IR renormalon puzzle. I will describe this later. This is really the way that perturbation theory diverges, how it diverges, and what is it controlled by, and what fixes the divergence of the perturbation theory. The other one that is not very well understood in the context of quantum field theory and quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, it's much better understood. The multi-instanton calculus, not just saddles, but in quantum mechanics and quantum field theory, we also have correlated saddles, or we can call them critical points at infinity in the FAM's old language, that the thimble is not necessarily Gaussian. And how do we work with this thing precisely? And also, the thing that one other thing that I will mention briefly is the meaning of non-instanton saddles in quantum field theory. There are many quantum field theories which has saddles different from the instantons. Okay. Now, probably I shouldn't say much about mathematical motivation. There were two excellent talks this morning. As I said, resurgence is the new idea due to Professor Ekal. And it is a unification of perturbation theory with non-perturbative sectors. And it has been studied rather deeply in the context of ODEs, nonlinear ODEs, integrations, and so on and so. And as we all know, in most cases, perturbation theory is divergent asymptotic expansion. So the idea is to elevate this series expansion into something called trans-series, a beast which involves not only expansion parameter, a series in the expansion parameter, but an expansion in terms of exponential of 1 over exponential of minus 1 over coupling, or logarithms, or multi-exponential, and things like that. And try to construct a trans-series that is well-defined under analytic continuation in such a way that it incorporates Stokes phenomena and Lefschetz thimble decomposition as precisely as possible. So this thing has the promise that perturbative and non-perturbative sectors in a given theory are deeply entwined. So this gives a different perspective, a sort of philosophical shift, at least in the context of quantum field theory, is that semi-classical potential, semi-classical expansion has the potential of being exact in some cases. Okay. Now, here is the outline of my talk. I will again describe some problems in quantum field theory, some standard problems in quantum field theory. Then I will describe resurgence in simple examples in quantum mechanics, and then tell you the difference between a typical quantum mechanical problem and a typical quantum field theory problem, namely the existence of something called infrared renormalons. And so I will tell you some hints about connection. There was already, it was already mentioned in this morning's talk about Lefschetz thimble decomposition and resurgent trans-series. Of course, these are all tied up with the complexification of the PET integrals, as well as it's also tied up, as mentioned this morning, with the WKB expansion, or sometimes called exact WKB or complex WKB. Now, so as a quantum field theorist, you are, in some sense, mentally forced to this program. There is really no escape in the standard discussion of the quantum field theory. So I will mention an example here, but the example can be literally anything. I took some sigma model whose target space is the complex projective space, CPN. Okay. For this particular model, large N methods are very successful, but many problems are unresolved at finite N. You can take any other two-dimensional sigma model, or whatever problems I will tell you are also existent in the context of, for example, quantum chromodynamics in four dimensions. Okay? So the first problem is, as I said, perturbation theory is asymptotic even after regularization and renormalization. This is, of course, everybody in this audience knows this, but it is useful to mention. So one question is there a meaning in perturbation theory? And we, in such type of theories, for example, CPN, it is classically scale invariant. There are instanton solutions. Usually, at least in the past, in the 70s, people talked about something called dilute instanton gas approximation. But this approximation is only valid in theories with scales. For example, in quantum mechanics, where instanton has a characteristic size, the saddle in the problem is characteristic size. So in theories which are classically scale invariant, instanton can be any size. And dilute instanton gas approximation assumes that the typical separation between saddles in the Euclidean space-time is much larger than the size of the saddle. But since the large size of the instanton it can be anything, literally, there isn't quite a meaning to this approximation. In Coleman's lecture, this is called infrared embarrassment, because we do not know what happens with the large size instantons. So in the past, primarily by Affleck and others, it was suggested that one can solve this issue with the scale of the instanton by putting an infrared regularization to the quantum field theory by putting quantum field theory in a box. Anyways, that's a very nice way to think about quantum field theory with some IR regulator, with some UV regulator to make it mathematically a better defined thing. But whenever you do that, whenever you put the theory on a circle, historically, people always thought about very often thermal compactification. So, and usually, if you have some interesting confining theory, it usually goes to another phase. It doesn't remain in the regime that you would like to study the theory. So there is also some incompatibility of the large N expansion with the dilute instanton gas. It is whether these two things are incompatible because we trust large N expansions, but we do not trust the dilute instanton gas in this context. And finally, I will explain later, in most of these theories, there is an IR renormal on ambiguity. This is a pathology put forward by Tuhuft many years ago, 30 or 40, oh God. Yeah, I cannot sum up. Subtract 79, and I will come to that later on. Okay, now, if you would like to understand these quantum field theories better, of course, we need useful tools, new useful tools. And from the mathematics side of the story, the new useful tool for us is resurgence theory and trans theories in their various incarnation. Because it tells us that as long as we are given a partition function, we can view many of the constructs that comes from a quantum field theory as some class of analyzable functions in the language of Eckhall. So, and there is also a geometric side of this story that has been discussed this morning. This is the complex Morse theory or Picard-Lefschetz theory. This is an attempt to find the cycles attached to the critical points. Okay, now, from the physics side, there are also two new inputs. One of them is we learn better how to do semi-classical analysis in a more reliable way. And this goes, you know, in combination with this idea of analytic continuity. And today I will tell you that the idea of adiabatic continuity, it is intrinsically tied up with mixed anomalies. So I will make that as precise as possible. This is sort of new perspective compared to our work from 2012. So here is a simpler question. The question is, can we make sense out of the semi-classical expansion? All of us know that semi-classical expansion is a trans-series expansion. It has a perturbative part. It has multi-instanton contribution. I omitted the logs momentarily there. And there are exponentials, which are instanton factors, saddle factors. And there are also fluctuations around those. Okay? And so all of the series that appears in this trans-series expansion are very generically asymptotic. Okay? So it has already been mentioned, if we have a divergent asymptotic expansion, we do construct a Borel transform. And from this Borel transform, we can do a Laplace integral. This Borel transform is a function of the Borel plane variable t. And this Laplace transform would give you something meaningful. This is the standard physical definition, of course, for this Laplace integral. You know, it depends on the orientation in the Borel plane. But this is something that physicists used, but it's a much more general beast than that, as we know now. So this Borel resumed version would be quite meaningful if this Laplace transform did not have any singularities in the direction of the integration. Okay? But usually, there are singularities. This is the Borel plane, as I showed, Borel T plane. There are singularities, either poles or cuts, in the Borel plane. And whenever we are doing these summations, we have to go either above or below these singularities. We can define left and right Borel resummation. And these two things differ from each other by some purely imaginary part. And very typically, in both quantum mechanics as well as in quantum field theory, this purely imaginary part, ambiguous imaginary part, has the form of an instanton, what physicists would call an instanton, but generally a saddle point contribution. Okay. And you can look to the discontinuity of these left and right Borel resummation, and the discontinuity is given in terms of a sum over these exponential factors. Okay. So now, this is the ambiguity of perturbation theory. We took something which was divergent and mapped it to something which is ambiguous, left-right ambiguous. Now, at least in the context of quantum mechanics, how to fix this pathology is understood in the early 80s by Bogomolny and Zinjustan. Now, they did it first in the context of double well. And if you look to, take time direction infinite, there are instanton, anti-instanton, instanton, anti-instanton. If you look to the typical textbook, you will see a picture like that. But in reality, apart from these instantons and anti-instantons, which has some characteristic size, okay, there are also correlated pairs, like instanton-anti-instantons or instanton-instantons. The characteristic size of these objects, these correlated events, is much larger than the instanton, but much smaller than inter-instanton separation. So when you are doing a semi-classical analysis, you have to take these things into account properly. Okay? So now there is a way to calculate the amplitude for these events, these instanton-instanton or instanton-anti-instanton events. And so you just, whenever you have these two objects, the separation between them is no longer a moduli. Now, the interaction depends on the separation, but it is a quasi-moduli, so you have to integrate over that. This is actually, in the modern language, this is part of the Lefschetz symbol connecting these two things. At least for the instanton-instanton, there is no fundamental difficulty. It's just an integration. You do it, you do get some meaningful results. However, if you try to do this integration over the quasi-zero mode for instanton, anti-instanton, at first you do get a meaningless result. And it is meaningful to get a meaningless result a posteriori. The reason is following. So if you actually, first, let me tell you what Bogomolnians in your standard, if you take the coupling constant to negative coupling, for example, okay, I am describing what they did, and do the integration, the integration becomes meaningful and you can do it. And then continue back to positive coupling that you would like to calculate, you get a twofold ambiguous result. So the reason at the very first place you get something nonsensical is because you are trying to calculate something manifestly ambiguous for real coupling constant. Okay? So it turns out that this event, correlated instanton, anti-instanton event, has a nice real part and also purely imaginary ambiguous complex part. Okay? Now, of course, we know this in retrospect quite well because we are on a Stokes line and it had to be so. Okay? Now, here is the magic that occurred in quantum mechanics and discovered by Bogomolnians in Houston, is that imaginary ambiguous part coming from perturbation theory and imaginary ambiguous part coming from the multi-instanton calculus cancel each other precisely. Bogomolnians in Houston show this at leading order, you know, just exponential factors and no fluctuations around them. But this statement works out at higher orders as well. Okay, this is the first glance of Borel-Eckel summability in the context of this particular PET integral for quantum mechanics. This can be either double well potential or periodic potential. It doesn't really matter. Okay. Now something I showed Gerald and I showed was that. So there is a particular rate of divergence in perturbation theory. It's not only n factorial, but there is an n minus 1 factorial there, n minus 2 factorial, so on and so forth. And all of them has these coefficients. But if you go on and continue imaginary part of the instanton anti-instanton amplitude, you see that there are fluctuations, quantum fluctuations around instanton anti-instanton, and they will give you a series in G square. And they come with these coefficients of a sub n, g squared, g to 4, g is my expansion parameter, so on and so forth. You see that if you do Borel resummation of the first thing up there, first asymptotic series up there, it actually cancels all the subleading terms down there as well. This is true in typical quantum mechanical systems with instantons. It works, we showed this for example, double well, as well as, periodic potential, for example. And there is also an appropriate factor coming from the instanton action, okay? Now, one manifestation of resurgence is that fluctuations about an instanton anti-instanton saddle are determined by those of the vacuum saddle. But how about the fluctuations around perturbative saddle versus instanton saddle? Now, because these are, in principle, this can be different in different topological sectors when you write down a PET integral. There, I used this quote from Eckel from early 80s, I think. The quote is that resurgent functions display at each order of their singular points a behavior closely related to their behavior at the origin, perturbation theory. Loosely speaking, this correction resurrect or surge up in a slightly different guise, as it were, at their singularities. Okay, so one question is whether there is a relation between perturbation theory around perturbative saddle as well as the instanton. And here I want to first make a remark. Actually, the answer to this question was understood long time ago in an almost unknown and unappreciated work of Alvarez and Casares. It's a very important work, in my opinion, but I think none of the experts in the field knew about it. We saw at least one paper of Casares on that. And indeed, you can put this machinery into work. You can calculate expansion around the instanton. Look at this resurgence line for arbitrary levels and for arbitrary level number and at desired order. You can put this to a Mathematica file and it gives you something, you know, at any desired order you get a result, 20th order, 30th order, it doesn't matter. This is something coming from, you can, the interesting thing is there is a precise relation. I will not tell you this relation because I want to go to quantum field theory. There is a relation, precise relation, very simple relation between perturbation theory around perturbative saddle and perturbation theory around non-perturbative saddles. And this morning there was a question about, you know, how can we show this, you know, by using Feynman graphs and things like that. With Feynman graphs, this calculation is actually extremely painful because even perturbative level, you do, you know, green functions in the background of an instanton, which is not quite easy, you know. Even the leading order results are difficult. And people actually calculated this, you know, Turbiner, Shuriak et al. And others calculated this at three-loop order. And the agreement is at seven decimal places. It's quite impressive, okay? But as I said, I would like to move to quantum field theory. And, but this is the state of affairs, at least in quantum mechanics. So why is this happening? Probably I should skip this slide because it's fairly elementary. But here is an ordinary integral. Let me mention at least four students. Okay, so here is an ordinary integral. We can deal with it with the steepest descent. We can deal with it exactly for this particular integral. It's probably some Bessel. And we can also deal with it by using critical points and Lefschetz symbols. So this integral has just two critical points. One of them is at zero, the other is probably at pi over two. And attached to each cycle, to each critical point, there's a symbol. It's actually a mathematical identity, exact identity, to write this down just before the Stokes line as a sum and, you know, or as a difference. So you can write it in these two manners. You see that cycle jumps, but the coefficients, which is integer in this particular case, also jumps in such a way that there are two jumps in the problem such that physical entity that you are calculating, namely the integral, does actually not jump, okay? This is also, the very same spirit is also present in many applications of the wall crossing. Okay, now, of course, the ambiguity in the left-right Borel resummation is actually the same thing as the ambiguity for the integral over the Lefschetz symbol J0. Exactly at the Stokes line, this integration contour jumps. You see that the tails on this integral, J0 cycle, the tails flip orientation. This is the imaginary ambiguity that we are getting, plus, minus, I times exponential of something, okay? So in this sense, left-right Borel resummation is some, in some sense, left-right Lefschetz symbol integration, okay? Now, probably I should also say that in order to determine these cycles, we do write down a complexified version of the gradient flow equation. I wrote it up there, starting with the action functional action of the zero-dimensional theory. And these gradient flow equations happens to be an instanton equation for one higher dimension. Here I am in zero dimension for this integral, and the gradient flow equations are this. And this is actually instanton equation in holomorphic supersymmetric quantum mechanics. Okay, so the story in quantum mechanics is actually a rather happy story. So there is there are still many unknowns for many systems, but we understand a great deal of the precise relation between perturbative vacuum and instantons, as well as perturbative vacuum and instanton anti-instanton sectors. Now, the question is whether this mechanism that works so nicely in the context of quantum mechanics can work in the context of quantum field theory, non-trivial quantum field theory? And the famous answer is no. The famous answer on R4 is due to Tuhuft from 79. And in 84, there is a very nice paper by François David, which says that on in the decompactification limit, we cannot get we cannot cure these ambiguities in the decompactification limit by semi-classical methods. Okay. Now, let me describe briefly why this doesn't work. And physicists know this in general. So, if you, of course, in CPN, as I said, there is instanton. There are instantons, and in some way, let's say you calculated instanton anti-instanton correlated event, and this gives you a singularity in the Borel plane. But this is a singularity which is very far from the origin. Okay, this red one is some instanton anti-instanton singularity. Okay, and things like that I think were put forward by Lipatov. Now, actually, if you look to Borel transform, it has many more singularities. If you are in CPN model of order n singularities, which are far more relevant than instanton singularity. Okay? But we do not know any semi-classical object which can accommodate, which can fix these pathologies. Okay? So this is the problem. These singularities are famously called IR renormalon by Tuhuft, the ones on the positive axis on the Borel plane. And there are no known semi-classical configurations which can fix these pathologies of the perturbation theory. Okay. Now, this is a real problem in QFT. There are some phenomenological approaches to this, to how to deal with this. But there is no satisfactory microscopic approach. Okay, so this is something I stole from one of the papers of Parisi. So he says there are new singularities which cannot be controlled by using semi-classical methods. But one thing we started to understand fairly recently is the following. What happens if you push a strongly coupled theory to a weak coupling regime without generating any phase transition, namely by keeping its character? And I will make this precise in a mathematical sense. I will write down a sort of a version of the partition function, not the usual thermal partition function, but a new partition function similar to index-like objects in supersymmetric theories. But this is possible. In most quantum field theories, you can push quantum field theory into weak coupling semi-classical regime without changing the ground state structure. Now, so what happens then, you know, in these theories? We know this very famously, for example, in supersymmetric theory, right, the way that Witten index is calculated, it's just using by compactification, and compactification preserves quite a bit of the character. For the index, it preserves, you know, it's independent of the compactification. Now, as I said, a traditional way of compactification that has been done in the literature of quantum field theory, usually, compactification reduce is viewed as an inverse temperature, and very large circle is close to zero temperature, very small temperature is close to very high temperatures, and very typically, there are either phase transitions or rapid crossovers. So there is some sort of singularity. And this idea of continuity or adiabatic continuity is an attempt to avoid all sorts of phase transitions in by any means possible. Is it possible? Yes. I wrote here the Witten index. And this thing is actually, if you compactify it on, say, R3 times S1, it doesn't matter, R times S1, it is independent of L. It is pure number. There is no non-analysis in it. So it tells you that as an idea, this is possible. The fact that in non-supersymmetric theories, such compactifications are possible has been, people started to understand these things starting in 2007. I think I did this with Larry Affe around that time, but then we started to understand in many other theories. Okay, so now let me consider CPN model. This N is a complex field, N modulo square is 1, it is the CPN field. One can do some decomposition into some angular part, into some radial part, this part, you know, this phi coordinate and theta coordinate. And one can do something interesting, actually. One can define this theory. Let me write this down. Is there a chalk? Okay. No, table, I'm sorry. Okay. So this N field, x1 comma x2 plus L, you can impose the following boundary condition, omega ij and j x1 comma x2, where this omega matrix is something of the form 1 exponential 2 pi I divided by n, so and so exponential I 2 pi n minus 1 divided by n. This is something which lives in the global symmetry of the theory. So it is for CPN, we have a global symmetry SUN. More precisely, it is PSUN. Okay? You can use such a boundary condition. Okay? So what does it tell us? It sort of forces the theory. Let me talk over this picture. If you do a regular compactification, all of us know that the modes in quantum field theory split up to usual Kaluza-Klein modes. And Kaluza-Klein modes are quantized in units of the 2 pi over L. Whenever you do this kind of twisted compactification, so the modes happen to be quantized in much smaller units. It is 2 pi over N L. Okay?
It's on circles?
Yeah. So you start with a theory, say, on R to the D, and you consider this on R to the D minus 1 times S1. Moreover, when you consider, for example, usual partition function, right, Z of beta, there is a trace, exponential minus beta H. Trace always mean in the pet integral formulation, there is a circle, and beta is the radius of that circle, okay, in the pet integral language.
And you assume the supersymmetry is unbroken?
For this construction, supersymmetry is immaterial.
How do you say that this trace is under compactification is the same number? Means if supersymmetry is broken, how can you say that?
Okay. In supersymmetric theory, if supersymmetry is not broken, then either broken or not broken, this is independent. In supersymmetric theory, this would be minus 1 to the f, and this would be independent of beta. And now, in non-supersymmetric theory, to find the counterpart of this thing is non-trivial. And actually, I wrote the formula a bit later, so sorry about that. Here it is. Oh, can you see it? Let me just write it. For example, in CPN, this boundary condition corresponds to the following partition function. Z of beta trace exponential minus beta h, and it is I 2 pi k divided by n, q sub k, product over k, and this q sub k are the charges associated with the SUN symmetry. Okay, this is not a regular partition function, but it's a graded partition function. The thing it does is that it takes the states in the Hilbert space, for example, some representation, and it grades them. It does exactly what supersymmetry does. In supersymmetry, you had Bose and Fermi, and you assign plus one to Bose states, minus one to the Fermi states. And here, this thing, if you have some many states here, it assigns phases. 1 exponential 2 pi I over n, exponential 4 pi I over n. And in this partition function, actually, in this partition function, this kind of, this class of graded partition function, you can actually construct things which are continuous as a function of beta.
Okay, but on this, actually, it doesn't matter, you know, in the SUSY or non-SUSY case, can we consider these generators as KDV or KP hierarchy? Because I know that, in principle, in the non-SUSY case, there is a possibility to construct this counterpart. In this, the question would be, these operators would correspond then to what?
In this case, these are some generators of the SUN flavor symmetry in this system.
So we can take them as a
conserved charges. Yeah. These are conserved charges which commutes with the Hamiltonian. Exactly.
Because for the non-supersymmetric systems,
there is no problem. Your trace is always over the whole Hilbert space. Yeah, and these charges commute with the Hamiltonian. And it doesn't matter if I deal with the supersymmetric theory or non-supersymmetry, and I can construct such objects. Now, this thing, this twist, from the pet integral point of view, corresponds to making Kaluza-Klein splittings much smaller at the tree level. Now, this is an interesting thing, actually, because you are on a finite circle. L can be very small, but you see there is something very funny going on. If you take n to infinity, this thing becomes a continuum. In quantum field theory, this is something very important, especially in lattice field theory. This is something known as Eguchi-Kawai reduction or volume independence. And when we were writing this, Gerald and I were putting these boundary conditions, we were very much influenced from that idea. And this Hamiltonian interpretation came a bit later. Okay. Now, actually, we wrote this kind of boundary condition literally by intuition. But very recently, this has been made much more rigorous. Now, I will state some facts in the case of CPN, but they are more generally true. Okay. To be more precise, for CPN model, for example, the global symmetry is not precisely SUN. It is SUN mod ZN. The reason for this is that in the CPN, we have U1 gauge redundancy. So, and ZN subgroup of PSUN is also part of U1 gauge redundancy. So because of that, the global symmetry is really SUN mod ZN. And it turns out that on R2, there is a mixed anomaly between this PSUN and charge conjugation symmetry. Okay, there is a mixed anomaly. This is due to Komargotsky, Seiberg, and others. Okay, and now, what does mixed anomaly means? It means that if you gauge PSUN, you lose charge conjugation symmetry. This has some implications for quantum field theory. It tells you that in a quantum field theory, is the vacuum of the quantum, only a finite number of possibilities are possible. Either one of these symmetries is broken, or the infrared theory is CFT, or you know, you have some TQFT supplementing the ground state of theory. You know, there has to be some TQFT. Okay? Now, how do we see that? Actually, if you just think the topological term in this theory, so it is of course quantized, it is just quantized in units of integer. This tells you that theta angle is 2 pi periodic. So now if you gauge PSUN, the topological term is modified like that. This A is a combined PSUN fields. I will not describe this procedure, but the topological term becomes quantized in units of 1 over n times an integer. This is, in mathematics, this is, I think, the Stiefel-Whitney, second Stiefel-Whitney class. Okay? Then this tells you that theta angle is 2 pi n periodic. So theta equal pi is no longer special, and you lose the charge conjugation symmetry. The thing that that is quite interesting is the following. If you do a normal compactification of this theory by thermal boundary condition, it turns out that you cannot preserve this mixed anomaly with normal compactification. You can preserve the mixed anomaly if and only if you impose this particular boundary condition, which corresponds to a background field for the PSUN. Okay? It is really an if and only if statement. So you can preserve the character of the theory, ground state structure of the theory, with compactification only if you use these boundary conditions. In this sense, this boundary conditions is unique. Okay? This is most clearly understood in a work by Yuya Tanizaki and his collaborators. And this is not only special for this theory. If you take, for example, supersymmetric version of this theory, there is a mixed, in that case, there is again a PSUN symmetry, but there is also a Z2N discrete chiral symmetry, and there is a mixed anomaly between the two. And actually, a very beautiful way to calculate Witten index is to do that in that theory. And just exactly this twisted, with this twisted boundary condition, you can do this calculation, and you can preserve the mixed anomaly at arbitrary compactification. I emphasize that no other boundary condition respects this mixed anomaly structure. Okay. So the story is quite general. If there is a mixed anomaly, this kind of twisted boundary condition can be used to guarantee the persistence of the anomaly. Okay. However, these boundary conditions are also present even in the case there are no anomalies. You can use them and preserve adiabatic continuity as much as you can. Even in CPN model, this mixed anomaly is only at theta equal pi. But you can use the boundary condition at theta equal zero as well. Or you can do the same thing in principal chiral model, which is a matrix model on group manifolds, or on Vesumino-Witten theory. Doesn't matter.
May I ask a question? Yeah, this is for individual M, yeah?
Yes.
How it works with large N expansion?
Large N works in general quite well, actually. This gives many things consistent with the canonical large N expansion. This is something that checked at the time. And as I said, you know, I made a picture here. So for example, in the case of the first one is the Hilbert space picture, what's going on in the Hilbert space. The second one is the path integral picture, and the last one is the anomaly picture. So what happens is that if, for example, in CPN model, gauge invariant states are in the adjoint representation or singlet representation of SUN, because the genuine symmetry is really PSUN. There is nothing in the fundamental representation of SUN. There cannot be. It is not gauge invariant, a state like that. So, and this thing, this twisted, this graded partition function takes these states and attach to each one of them different phases. So when you do the state sum, there is immense amount of cancellation between states. And so much so that when you go to small circle, normally every state would contribute. You know, all the worth of the Hilbert space would be there. But if you do this particular compactification, only a handful of states, one, two, sometimes, if you take large N limit, it is literally one state contributing, and it is the ground state. Okay? So, and because of this structure, this kind of object preserve adiabatic continuity. So, now let us turn back to our story about non-perturbative saddles in the problem. Because at least when we reduce to quantum mechanics in this way, we should be able to deal with interesting topological configurations. Here what happens, okay? This is a picture of the instantons. The first one, this is for CP2, so N equal 3. The first one is the regular thermal compactification. Take an instanton and change its size moduli. You see that one lump there, or spike there, which looks like spike, but it is rather smooth. it sort of spreads out and it becomes just one lump. Its action is whatever it is, it's independent of that. But if you put this non-trivial flavor holonomy, this background, what happens is that this is n equal 3, so the usual instanton splits up to n objects, n saddles, n different saddles. This is a fractionalization of the usual BPSD instanton saddles to some fractional objects, okay? So this is for SU3, it splits up to 3, but in general it splits up to n. This will have some very interesting implication because the action of these configurations will be proportional to 1 over n. Now, actually you can classify these saddles. They happen to be, you know, these tunneling events. They are in correspondence with the root system of the Lie algebra. Maybe this is coroutes, I don't know. You can write the direction. If you choose this particular background, the direction is 1 over n of the instanton action. And you can show that the 2D instanton action can be written as a product of these fractional instanton actions. And here this K sub V is the dual Coxeter label for each. So you see, maybe dual Koch label, I'm sorry. Coxeter number is some of them. Dual Coxeter number is just some of them. So this splits in a Lie algebraic way, these objects. Okay. Now, the interesting thing is this dual Coxeter number is related to the beta function of gauge theory. For all sigma models, this is true. Okay. So this fractionalization is very important for at least IR normalon problem. You can go to this quantum mechanics. You can calculate mass gap as an energy splitting between ground state and first excited state. You find something which is exponential 4 pi over lambda. Remember that lambda is g square n. Okay, remember that the usual instanton would give exponential minus 4 pi divided by g square, which would be exponentially smaller than this. And it does something very interesting. Okay, so in particular, concerning your question, for example, the usual instanton factor in this theory is 4 pi over g square. If you work with the two-hoofed limit by keeping lambda g square n fixed, this is proportional to exponential minus n. This is the irrelevance of the usual instanton in the usual large n limit. But you see here that these things are really coming with weight exponential 4 pi g square n, and this is finite in the large n limit. So it's perfectly nicely compatible with the large n limit. And the result is also, by the way, compatible with the mass gap that's obtained in the large n limit that's discussed in the textbooks. Now, of course, these one instantons, these fractional instantons, as in the case of quantum mechanics, is not the whole story. You can write correlated events. You can write instanton, anti-instanton correlated events. So the separation between them is a quasi-moduli again, quasi-zero mode. And you can find the amplitudes. So there are two kinds of, in some sense, two events. One of them is you tunnel in one way and you come back, or you tunnel in one way, you come back in the other direction. And the second thing that I wrote there, you tunnel and come back to the same place, the counterpart of the usual anti-instanton, anti-instanton in quantum mechanics is very important. If you calculate its amplitude by using either this method of Bogomolnyi's Injustan, or in the modern language, by doing an appropriate Timbal integration over the quasi-zero mode direction, you do get this correlated amplitude. And you see that it is twofold ambiguous. Of course, this would tell you that there is something manifestly wrong with this semi-classical expansion, because you are trying to calculate something meaningful and you are getting something twofold ambiguous and not so meaningful. In the past, at least 70s, 80s, people cared with this kind of things. At least in the context of quantum mechanics, few people cared. like Bogomolny and Zinjustan, but it is, I do not think that it is appreciated in its widest generality. Even if you look to Polyakov model, this issue is there even in Polyakov model, but he didn't write anything about it, you know. So, and these things are important and interesting because, for example, one can do perturbation theory in the reduced quantum mechanics, and this is done very nicely in a, again, virtually unknown paper by Mike Stone and Reeve, and you can derive perturbation theory. By the way, there is a Mathematica program now out there. It's available on the Wolfram library. It is written by Tin Süleyman Pasic. He is at your neighboring institution here. And you give it to it, and it calculates this growth up to 500 order in an hour. If you want 200 order, it is 10 minutes. Okay, maybe less, I don't know. So you indeed, you do, for example, you can do left and right Borel resummation, and you do get this ambiguity. And again, by this Borel-Yekal resummation, these ambiguities cancel. However, there is something magical that happened at this stage. That is, although we are in quantum mechanics and the cancellation is something that looks manifestly quantum mechanical, something magical happened. That magical thing is, actually, this was an ambiguity that I called IR renormal on. This beta zero there is 1 over n. It is closer to origin compared to usual instanton anti-instanton by a factor of n. So this is exactly the location of the Tuhoft's IR renormalon. This is quite interesting. I should say that at least in CPN, these points matches exactly. But in general, it didn't need to be so. You know, there may be some numerical differences. For example, in pure Young-Mills, you do get 1 over n, but you do not get 11/3. You know, from the that appears in the beta function. So it is a little bit numerical accident here, to be strictly honest about it. But it is also exactly the location of this IR renormalon. So in 79, Tuhoft asked this question, can we make sense out of QCD or QFT in general? And the reason he thought that this was quite unlikely was because he thought that it wasn't quite possible to understand these IR renormalons by semi-classical means. And I think this is really at least one way of making the theory calculable and seeing that this Tuhoft idea that IR renormalon is there and it cancels with something is actually correct. Sort of realization of an old dream. Just this is a side remark. For example, there are other saddles, for example, non-self dual saddles. If you look to principal chiral model, you know, there are there. Uhlenbeck, Karen Uhlenbeck actually did an explicit construction for them. She called them unitons. And in physics literature, they were quite not understood at all. But late, you know, if you insist on this kind of boundary conditions, these twisted boundary conditions, you can show that these unitons fractionates again. Very similar story. You understand great deal of their structure. Of course, principal chiral model is also very interesting because if you add the Vesumino term, it becomes the Vesumino-Witten model. You can understand the theory quite precisely by using compactification and by looking to anomalies and semiclassics. Now, this is the sort of emerging picture. At least in semiclassical domain, this is some sort of resurgence triangle. There is a perturbative vacuum, and underneath that, there are things like instanton, anti-instanton, of the, you know, with topological charge zero, but finite action. And whenever there is a pathology up there, it is fixed by the thing which is down there. And There are other topological sectors, for example, these fractional instantons and fluctuations around it. And they are also tied up in some way with the perturbative vacuum, at least in the context of quantum mechanics. So at least in the regime where semiclassics is reliable, this has a potential to give a more or less complete non-perturbative description of the QFT. I think it has such a prospect. We are still working on this kind of problems. I was hoping to, you know, report on some progress in Schwinger model, but I got confused, so I will not report on that. But yeah, so the idea is that, you know, every pathology within the theory fixes with, you know, another thing which looks again ambiguous within the same theory, and this is very in spirit. This is the idea of median resummation in resurgence theory that Jean Eckhall put forward, and also very nicely reviewed, and also generalized in the work of Ricardo and others. Now, there was in this morning some remarks in resurgence theory concerning PET integrals. So this is a very active topic. It is the complexification of the field space and finding the critical points and associated thimbles. In general, it's a very hard and interesting problem. And in this context, I just want to mention one interesting problem. At least when we were dealing with this kind of saddles, we also encountered some very weird-looking saddles. Because when you complexify field space, you do not only get nice, real solutions, but you do also get some interesting solutions, which may be complex, sometimes multivalued and singular. And in the past, usually, if you have something even discontinuous, it is rejected in the context of the PET integration, because they were just thinking in the context of real PET integrals. And of course, in that case, they would cause infinite action. But it turns out that in the newer version of the story, the space of saddles is much richer and much interesting. And things that that were not to be appropriate in the past turns out to have to be appropriate and have finite action configuration. One such thing is following, one such example. This is, for example, supersymmetric version of the double well. You know, nice example, just supersymmetric version. You can actually integrate out fermions exactly. You can go to Hamiltonian, construct a graded Hamiltonian plus minus in the bosonic Hilbert space, fermionic Hilbert space. And in those spaces, this potential looks like a tilted double well. And tilting is just only of order of h bar. It's small. Now, if you look to this system, you would think that, you know, you can ask, is there a non-perturbative saddle contributing to the PET integral? In this system, first of all, I should say that supersymmetry is broken. Okay, there is a non-perturbative ground state energy, positive ground state energy. But if you just look, invert this potential, as I did there, and look to a solution, you know, in the space of real paths, there is no finite action solution. I mean, if a ball starts to roll down from that hilltop, it will roll down and overshoot. It will go to infinity. It will not come back. But if you write down complexified version of the gradient flow equation, so this was, for example, let this be the field del phi over del u. This depends on time and gradient flow time minus del s bar over del phi bar, again, t and u. And if you write down, on the right-hand side, you can write down the complexified version, holomorphic version of the equations. And there is actually a solution. it goes there, and if the energy was lower than E2 there, it would go roll to that direction and turn back from the real turning point. But up there, what happens is that there is a solution. It goes there, hits a turning point in the complex domain, and comes back. Okay, this is sort of a complex solution. Now, this first plot here is the bounce at the level E2. It starts from there, rolls up there, and comes back. But if you, the other one, this thing, as I said, is a complex object. It has both real and imaginary parts. Black part is the real part, and red part is the imaginary part. It does something interesting. And on the way, you see that it has an imaginary part also. And if you calculate the action, this imaginary part turns out to be quite meaningful. And it actually gives a purely IPy contribution to the action. And a topological angle, but it is sort of hidden in the Lefschetz symbol, on the Lefschetz cycle. So actually, this thing, this overall sign, guarantees that if this sign was not there, semi-classic would tell you that ground state energy is negative. But that wouldn't be consistent with supersymmetry, because supersymmetry tells us that ground state energy is positive semi-definite. And this complexity of the solution and the fact that imaginary part is IPy turns out to be quite important to understand full dynamics non-perturbatively. I will just mention one other example, then stop. This is an example which we have periodic potential, cosine potential. Now, if you integrate out fermions, you can again write down H plus H minus Hamiltonians in the bosonic and fermionic Hilbert space. And the potential looks like this. Okay, so sort of it has a, there is a gap here of order of h bar. But if you are looking to the ground state properties, naively you may think that there is only one saddle and it contributes, you know, the tunneling from here to there. And this would actually give a positive ground state energy. But it is known that in this system, the supersymmetry is in fact not broken. And the resolution of that is that there is another saddle which sort of goes halfway, hits a complex turning point, and comes back. And the action and property, many properties of these two saddles are actually exactly the same. The only difference is their phases by pi. So the summation of these two gives you zero. This is the semi-classical reason why, you know, the ground state energy stays zero in this theory. You know, this is sort of interesting, because if you were to ask this question to a traditional quantum field theorist, you know, even some of the best quantum field theorists, give this potential and ask ground state energy, they would tell you that because of this thing, ground state energy would be negative, they would tell you. But the contribution of this is positive, the complex one. And the reality, it is zero. So there is this kind of very delicate cancellation. One very interesting thing is this solution, the real solution, is completely smooth. You know, it is nice and smooth. But the other solution is very bizarre. You know, if you move a little bit away from the Stokes line, this smoothens out. But if you are exactly on the Stokes line, this actually real part has a discontinuity, but so does the imaginary part. The imaginary part blows up. And this turns out to be still finite action, because, you know, this the kinetic term in the holomorphic variable z dot square is, if you just look to the real part of this complexified quantum mechanics, it is x dot square minus y dot square. So the kinetic term is not a positive definite sign in terms of these variables. So something that blows up here cancels with something that blows up there. And you can show this quite precisely by regulating this, by moving just a little bit off the Stokes line. So indeed, these solutions are there, and they contribute, and they do very interesting things. Now, let me summarize. So I think these ideas, semi-classics, resurgent semi-classics, you know, mixed anomalies, adiabatic continuity, can be used to our great advantage to learn about non-perturbative aspects of quantum field theories, either asymptotically free or otherwise. And maybe even some people started discussing these kind of things. It may have some useful region of overlap with lattice field theory. Some things can be tested. And the space of saddles now is actually richer than we anticipated maybe 10 years ago. And there are many interesting things. So I think I should stop here.
Questions?
Yeah, one comment. I think the necessity of complex saddles was already quite established by Boros and company. I mean, of course, your examples are a little bit more dramatic because not including embedded symmetry and so on. But in the famous paper by Valli and Parisi and Boros, he really made clear that if you don't include saddles, you will never get the right.
I totally agree with you. It is my omission. Sorry about that. Yeah.
One more substantial question. So, typically, the normal ones are associated to subsequences of diagrams that diverge factorially, right?
Right.
So, when you do this adiabatic compactification, what happens to these diagrams? Because I think there is a paper by Tin, right?
Yeah, there is a paper by Tin.
These diagrams do not diverge anymore. So, in a sense, you cut this renormal singularity from the very beginning.
It transforms to something else, probably. Okay, so we do not know the details of how this adiabatic continuity works. But the fact that these, indeed, the class of diagrams that used to be called renormalon diagrams on R4, on R2, when you compactify them, they are not contributing in the way that they used to do on R4. They only do so if you take n equal infinity limit, but n equal infinity is same as decompactification. So my best guess is that they really transmute, you know, in this effective quantum mechanics, because of this holonomy background, you are really inducing a potential on these manifolds. Okay, so I think this thing is transmuting to that. But this is an outstanding question, and I think extremely hard question. I wish I knew the answer. And I wish somebody, you know, can answer that question in, you know, near future. It's a very important question, and I don't understand how that happens precisely.
But you would expect that as L goes to infinity, you would go smoothly from this description to the standard R2 description.
Okay, this is actually the talk that I planned to give, but I couldn't finish it completely. But I will tell you one very nice example, okay? So at least in one theory, we were able to calculate an observable for any compactification reduced. I will only plot that. This is actually the work by Sash. I think I wrote it, but and Vip. And they consider Schwinger model in two dimension, 1+1. And they look to chiral condensate. And actually, on R times S1 beta, you can do this for this model as well as any generalization of this. There are also generalization of this Schwinger model that has been discussed recently. You know, on R times S1, we can calculate this condensate on small circle by instanton methods. And it gives us something like that, okay? But reliability of semi-classics breaks down here. Don't take that part literally. And now this is condensate, this is compactification reduced. And you can take the exact result and plot it as a function of L. And the result is this, okay? Now, if you take the exact result, you know, which is here, the result was an instanton effect. It is some number divided by some coupling times beta. And this E beta is the expansion parameter. If you take the exact result, there is an expansion of that in this form, okay? And you can plot this, and it is actually that. Okay, but we didn't calculate this perturbative thing exactly. We just we just realized that from the exact result you can deduce such an, and there is no other factor. So this is one example where, in the context of quantum field theory, one thing that you calculate by semi-classical methods interpolates, when you take the full fluctuations around this thing, interpolate to the result on R2. So for many things that we did by using compactification, we actually expect this kind of behavior. One reason underlying this is this idea of Eguchi-Kawai large and volume independence. Because in many of these theories, if we take large n limit, we can actually prove this constancy in the large n up to 1 over n corrections.